Okay. That's not a lot of reasons, and you can fully deal, like there's just so many positive things,
Yeah, definitely.
That's a new character.
Yeah.
No, it's not a part two.
I know.
Yeah. That's like,
I mean,
honestly, if I tore an ACL, then I would not get the surgery, but I'm also ancient.
You're not,
maybe not
I
healing.
Are you getting anxious?
You are unmuted, Madam Chair.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Has everyone had a chance to read and not make any changes to the minutes from our meeting dated August 29th?
No changes.
If that is the case, can I have a motion to approve the minutes?
Sure. I'll make a motion to approve the minutes from the meeting of 8/29/23.
I'll second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Hello, everybody. That's up there. Nice to see you. Did anyone receive any correspondence or community input?
No.
I have not. No, I have not.
I have not either.
Madam Chair, if I may.
Of course.
I have had communication from a parent about the morning buses.
Yeah.
And obviously, I also want to mention the buses that have been showing up in a timely fashion at the Swampscott Middle School. So a parent told me that there is confusion in the morning. One bus has everyone on it, and then the other bus is empty. So I communicated with the new operations manager at the OE Bus Company, and she spoke with the bus drivers and said, literally, that students are purposefully not getting on one of the bus so they could be together. And whether they all want to get to the middle school together, or they all want to delay getting on the bus and have more time together. So starting yesterday, the buses in the morning that are going around town basically at the same time, a couple of minutes early, are waiting here at the middle school together so that the bus drivers break up the students into relatively equal numbers. They don't have to be exactly equal, but so, literally for the first week of the school year, it's interesting, we never had this issue before, never heard of it before. One of the buses was empty and one was overloaded.
Yes. I will say there was always one bus that was significantly more crowded than the others, I have heard. I didn't know that the other ones were empty.
Yeah.
But so when you say they're waiting at the elementary school here.
They're waiting here at the Johnson School, yeah. Yes. Today when I came in early just to make sure, and yes, the buses did wait together. One was in the front of the school, one was at Flash Road, and then drove around and got behind the other bus, and then I'm not sure how the students decide which bus to get on, but the bus drivers have the responsibility of making sure that none of the buses are overloaded. Let's put it that way.
But so were they, but when we got the bus schedule, it was at a certain time.
Mm-hmm.
And so it sounds like the concern is that the times have changed and that hasn't
it's
been.
It's 2 minutes. The buses were 2 minutes apart.
But I think that the timing that they're going around is like probably a 10-minute difference.
Yes.
And so people are.
So particularly for us this morning, like this is my input, not community input. Like my son was there 10 minutes early, and within 2 minutes of the time expected to the bus to come, he said that he got a call from another friend that the bus had already passed the police station, which is our bus route. So my concern was, oh my goodness, okay. So we hopped in the car to try to get to the last stop, which would have been on the hot road, and there was no bus there. So I don't know how that happened. I don't know how it was so early, but it was not there at 7:29, and he was there early.
Yeah, I think that's the time, because they're doing this thing together, I think the tricky thing is that the times are different by like,
I was told that this morning by the
that they were the same
that they were not. My assumption is
maybe the bus was full, and that's why it passed.
The bus shouldn't go by any bus stop.
Yeah.
You know, I'll talk to it again. Are you sure that was the last bus? Are you sure there wasn't a bus coming?
That's right. So I'm not sure about that.
I bet there was another bus coming.
And he could have maybe waited.
Right.
But I think what happened was that 7:29 bus he assumed was coming, which he was early for, and never came. So then I think he thought, I missed the bus. And I didn't think to think,
Yeah.
Oh, we should wait.
Yeah.
Because I just then went to the next stop. So, okay. Okay.
So, I'll check again to make sure that I was told, because I asked that. I had this huge conversation about how do we have to change the morning schedule? And the operation manager said, no, if we have the two buses leave Johnson School at the same time, then we won't have to change any of the schedules. Because here they were, I think there were a 2-minute difference at the Johnson School. I think one was 31 and one was 32, maybe, or something. So I'll keep working on it. The afternoon issue has theoretically been solved. They have reversed the pickup between the high school and the middle school so that the buses are leaving at a much more comfortable time. And I spoke to Jason Kaufman today, and he did not mention an issue, and I'm sure he would have. So I think the afternoon has been solved.
Okay.
So now we'll work. I'll speak to her again to make sure that everyone's meeting the schedule. I did make sure everyone had that schedule, because sometimes people think they know the schedule. So last week I sent everybody involved, the high school principal, all the secretaries, I sent Mr. Andrews' copy, our administrative assistants, obviously the bus company, and I said, what needs to change? And the response was nothing. So I'll double check.
Okay. Because what I can, I guess, can I ask you a question? I'm sorry that this is dragging on, but I'm like, so if the expectation for a particular bus stop was 7:29 and the bus was early, from what I could tell, it would have been Bad Tides as the last stop. But what do you mean the last bus? Wouldn't have that have been the last time to get the bus? Like, if
there are three buses.
Right, but
is 7:29 at your pickup the third bus?
Yes.
Okay.
And we only have one bus that moves around for us. And so, you know, if we miss it, but couple of times in the morning it had come early, even just by like, so it, you know, they were out there early, 5 minutes early, which it says that's what you need to be. So 5 minutes early, and then the bus was still early and they ran to it.
Right. And Connor,
and what was that last part?
They ran to it. Like they ran to the
bus. So I will I will communicate to the operations manager who's new. And had a family issue right before the school year started that covered the first 2 or 3 days of school, but she's back now. That if a bus is early at a bus stop, they are to wait.
Yeah, right.
Till the appointed time.
Right. Yes, yeah. That's what should happen. Really what
that's,
needs to happen, because I think for certain stops, that's the only stop we, like that's the only stop we have.
Yeah.
And that's the last bus.
Same.
Yeah.
And he was there 10 minutes ago.
Okay. Well, then there's no, absolutely no reason.
That's, like, that's what I'm trying to say. It's
if
like,
if it was, what day? Monday?
Yesterday?
Monday. Yeah. It was yesterday. The bus was very late.
Yeah. Right. Which is the other thing we heard. And they're just still figuring it out.
And if I could chime in as well. As a outside party, is that possible?
Yes, if you could state your name and address.
Jenny Lau, 25 Baker Road.
And Jenny?
So it seems like there's a common pattern, and I get what you're saying, Mr. Parentazzi, but I do think that the bus drivers have not stick to the schedule. So there's something going on that end. Just reports from fellow moms and things that just aren't adding up. So I think there are probably two different things going on. We need to look at where the buses are stopping, but more importantly, what's happening this year, right now, where they're stopping. I'm not sure that anyone's looked at it in detail.
May I ask a question, Madam Chair?
Of course.
Jen, are you suggesting or stating that they're not stopping at the appointed stop they're supposed to be stopping at?
Correct. So we're in Little Nahant, and it's, I'm not going to lie, it's not a disadvantage that the buses are willing to stop here at will. But what happens is whatever bus comes through Nahant first picks up every Little Nahant kid, and then they take off. And then the other buses are, you know, filling the kids. So I think there are two separate issues. The bus company is not on schedule, right? So I'm not, that is difficult for me to reconcile that you were at the school, you saw the buses, they, so maybe they're trying to get their groove. I'm not sure. But that doesn't make sense with what I'm hearing from other moms, which is that they're not showing up this morning. There was another case last week where a mom was waiting 20 minutes and the bus finally showed up. So it's not adding up. So I think we need to investigate it a little bit further.
I will do that. As a matter of fact, I will do it before the meeting's over. I'm typing an email now.
Thank you.
And I apologize, Jen, for any inconvenience. Obviously, I was here this morning purposefully before, it was definitely before 7:15, it could have been 7:10, and there were two buses here at the Johnson School. So why they would be late, obviously I don't know how accurate they are to the stops, but I'll find out and we'll correct it. And I apologize to everyone.
There's no need to apologize. I think that it's just about all of us connecting, communicating. There are lots of pieces to this to make sure that everyone's taken care of and that the kids are just, it's seamless. And so don't apologize.
Thank you.
Okay, I won't.
Are there any other comments? There are no comments. We'll move on to the examination and the authorization for the board of books.
Thank you, Madam Chair. In your packet, labeled item 5, you have the bill roll, which totals $44,827.33. And I respectfully ask a member of the school committee to make that motion to approve them. When I'm done, I will go quickly. Amazon is a combination of office supplies and school materials and supplies. That totals $2,207.68, all those small numbers. The Massachusetts Partnerships for Youth is our annual membership that will be paid for by grant. Learning Without Tears is about reading and writing. IXL is our annual license for $2,188. I don't have to explain extermination. Wilson is books. Irving Sons is a plumber. We had two things done. The last time we had an enormous burst of rain, we had some backup. So the first of those two bills is for snaking our main lines out, which had some organic material in them. And the second is putting new seals in the toilets, because when that happened, we found out that some of the toilets didn't even have, you know, that wax seal that goes between the pipe and the toilet. So some of our toilets didn't even have them. So we had those installed. Speece Corner is special education supplies. Rochester is reading. RP O'Connor is labor for our temperature control system, which is annual. Obviously, Stop and Shop is food service. Follett is books. AT&T is phone, as is Verizon. I have some good news about Verizon for a change. I was getting very confused because Verizon kept billing us and saying we didn't pay our bill and then blah, 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 blah. So I did an analysis last week of all of our Verizon bills. And it's complex because we pay Verizon to make a connection with our internet and, you know, it's all over the place. I found that there were two lines that we were being charged for that we don't believe are being used by anybody in the town. And the fire chief and I have searched and searched. So he is going to turn them off. And actually, he's going to do a research project to see what they are. But I think we're paying for two lines that either aren't used at all or are being used by someone else. And so starting now, the being used by somebody else is probably inaccurate because I called both of the numbers and it just rang and rang and rang and rang. So, you know, when you went from fiber optic to computerization and there, you know, we had dozens of copper lines. And so the chief and I, Chief Austin and I are going to make a recommendation to Tony Barletta to have an auditor come in and research all of the copper lines to see, because there may be dozens of them. And we don't know. I have a picture of the phone station at the firehouse, and it's actually hilarious, you know, where there's wires coming in and then jumped and re-jumped, and it really does take a professional to figure it out. Verizon will do it free up into the firehouse's main box. But then once a wire leaves that main box, it's up to the user. So that's why we think we should get somebody to not only look at the firehouse, but also look at the police station and look at, you know, town hall and really come here and look at us. Maybe we have more. Somebody else is paying for it. I mean, I wouldn't know. So that's a little bit of good luck. To be balanced by the bad luck that I had to make a repair call to Verizon today because I got a report that the green box on the corner of Flash Road and Castle Road was open and kids were messing around in it. So, so we went out, we closed the door, but there's no lock on it. So at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning, Verizon's going to be here and hopefully put a lock on that. So I now know much more about phones than I want to.
Well, thank you.
So the next two are our utility bills, and wouldn't it be nice if our gas bill was always $190 a month? School specialty or supplies and materials, Justice Resource Institute, that's for a special education tuition, which includes 7 days a week room and board. And we are going to a meeting in 2 weeks about that student. And I'm challenging the bill because it's my understanding that that student is doing very, very well, which is great, and is spending 2 days a week, the weekends, back at home. So my question is, why are we paying for 7 days a week? So I'll be able to hopefully tell you that next time. The Self Integrity Learning Solutions is an interesting bill. That's actually half of our internet service bill because we pay the other half with a federal grant. So this is the net. And that's it.
I can make a motion. I can make a motion for our school committee to please approve the total of $44,827.33.
Can I have a second?
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Moving on.
Thank you.
To the principal's report.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm happy to present my report this evening. I believe you have a copy 6A in your packet. Under the area of student, families, and community, we took part in our September 11th commemoration, at the firehouse. Fourth and fifth grade attended, and they appreciated being part of that. And it was brief but solemn, and we're glad to take part in these types of community events. The Nahant Police Department held a very successful car seat program this week. They had a grant for free car seats, and these were really high quality equipment. And they offered several of those to family members in town, and they installed them. They also checked car seats for families that had them already installed. And that was just one of several of these events they're going to be doing at the school. This was kind of the dry run. So they have a nice grant to fund it, and I think it's a great service. I wanted to let you know that I was able to meet with the fifth grade teacher, Aunt Ms. Kovis, and talk about our K-5 Buddies program. And we have a 1-to-4 ratio of fifth to K, but we're going to make it work. It's going to be great. They're going to have art activities, seasonal activities. I imagine they'll use the cafeteria or bigger spaces. But I can picture, a fifth grader working with a small group of kindergartners.
Nice.
We wouldn't want either one to miss the opportunity.
Yes.
So the fifth grader may be a sixth grader here next year, and they'll have another set of buddies.
Yeah.
But the kindergartner won't have another opportunity. And so we want to make sure the kindergartners have that opportunity as well.
Be on the lookout for any future teaching
time. Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah, it helps the social emotional growth. It helps the fifth graders or older students take ownership for their school community and recognize that they're role models. And that's really a big part of the program. And everyone benefits. We have Veterans Day planning underway. Again, with a smaller fifth grade, we're looking to include the third and the fourth grade and also make it a school-wide assembly. In the past, it's been sixth graders performing for veterans. The number of veterans is declining, and the school would like to see the assembly of themselves. And so we've broken up our historic assembly and spread it out over several grades. There'll be poetry recitation, song, explanation of the holiday. And so we're looking forward to that. We'll also, of course, invite veterans. NEF had a wonderful fundraiser. I want to thank them. They raised $3,000 at a golf event for the music program. And NEF and I met with Mr. Bullock as well. They're planning a field trip and some equipment for the music department. And so we're looking at a school-wide field trip, perhaps to North Shore Theater. We've gone there in the past. It could be good for a wide grade span. And so we're looking at a field trip and music support. We had a wonderful open house. It felt like it was well attended. Parents seemed happy about what they heard from teachers. They had a chance to hear myself talk about what new initiatives we have at the school and then visit their classes. And teachers presented twice the same program so that families who had two children could see both teachers. Our Norman La Liberté exhibit is continuing. We're going to have Historic Society members come to the school to observe the art classes that is part of that exhibit. And as a reminder, the students' artwork will be going to the Historic Society and be part of this very special exhibit that's taking place. And we're also looking forward to having some students take field trips to the Historic Society to see that exhibit for themselves. And then finally, under Student, Families, and Community, I was able to attend a PBDSS Museum meeting over the weekend. They have an opening of a new exhibit that's featuring artists Michael Afossi and Richard Alexander, who make origami. And so they'll be coming to the school and doing origami classes with the classes. And it's actually a math workshop. Students might not know that, but there's going to be symmetry and fractions involved. And this will be either funded by a Mass Cultural Council event grant or PTO and NEF fundraising, depending if the grant comes through. But I'm going to be writing a grant to have them come out. And again, they are world-renowned origami artists. They have 5 books published, and they have several works at the PBDSS. So they're really fantastic. And they're really they're really great folks. I've been on the board with them, Mr. Bossy, for some time, and I've just gotten to know them, and it's been great to have them here. In the area of technology, Parent Square update, I was able to meet with teachers and talk about the different options that we have in Class Dojo. We looked at Remind, and we would like to recommend that we have support for Parent Square. It's out of those, the other two I mentioned are no cost, but they really only have one feature, which is texting. Parent Square gives, I mentioned before, a phone number to teachers, and they can use that to call homes during class hours or outside class hours if they like. They can use it to text. I can use it to text. And it has a real lot of great features that we could really take advantage of. It could replace Constant Contact, which we currently pay for, has newsletter templates, a good training system, and it's also used by SwampScott. So my recommendation to the superintendent is that we move forward with this program. He was able to negotiate a bit on the price today, as he will.
Of course.
And I don't know if you want to take it from here, Tony, on that piece.
I would. Thank you. So everyone involved thinks Parent Square is the way to go. And I support that because, we're trying to take decision-making and make it a collaborative effort. And obviously, as members of the school committee have mentioned, that if we begin to use one in earlier grades when parents get to SwampScott, there's not going to be any transition. So Mr. Andrews did the web training with the company and then turned it over to me. So they wanted $3,600 a year for the enhanced version, which we want, and that's pretty inclusive. And then the virtual phone, they wanted an additional $600 a year. And then there's a $500 setup cost, because when you set things up, obviously it takes time. So that total was $13,100. Today I called one of the sales managers and I said, come on, we're really small. So she spoke with her boss and I got a quote now for $11,900. And that's for 3 years. So I don't believe you have to approve it because it's simply an expenditure and it's administrator, but obviously we wanted to talk to you before spending that kind of money. So if you support that, then next meeting, I will have an invoice for you to approve.
I support it, yeah.
That's great, absolutely. How soon could it be up?
We're looking at November-ish. Because there has to be training, obviously. We have to communicate it to the parents. We have to develop with the company an online or text training. We don't want to inconvenience his parents, say, you got to come to this training. We want to send the training to them. So it'll take a while. It'll also take a while to interface with our student support and student information systems. So it will take a while, but we're excited about it. I mean, it's just going to make communication so much easier.
That's great.
And I know those of you who have been using Parent Square have reported very positive things.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Absolutely.
They said 3 to 5 weeks to onboard us, and however long the training takes us. We have November 1st outlined for one of the trainings for staff. And we could also have an evening training at the Parent Teacher Conference evening. We also are moving forward with the parent portal and report cards, recognizing that one thing that Parent Square, I'm not sure if it does, it may not pull up attendance from School Brains. And School Brains is still our student database. And so we want to move forward with the parent portal as an option for parents to correct their own cell phone number without having to call the office, see report cards, and check on attendance. So we are going to be this week sending out an email to parents with their login credential so that they can log into the parent portal on School Brains and see what that looks like. And we expect that the first trimester report card will be published there. And the last trimester report cards are already there. So we've gotten those report cards up. And then I'll also be presenting the concept of using the gradebook and discussing with teachers whether they want to use gradebook in the parent portal so they could see, you could see quarterly tests, quizzes, things like that.
Madam Chair, if I may, confidentiality of student information is crucial. So this will have to be done in multiple steps. Parents will have to be informed that we're going to be doing it. Then each parent will have to get a unique identifier that only they can use. We have to caution them, don't give it to anybody, because if you do, then your student information, which involves a lot of things that nobody wants anywhere other than in a very small, like for example, I won't have any, classic example. So it'll take us some time and multiple steps to get the portal functioning. Once it does, it'll be very convenient for parents to use it and to get a lot of information. And obviously, you know, when you combine the last two things we've talked about, we're really improving communication tremendously in a very short period of time.
I was able to get out a student directory to parents. This was a simple list of parents' names, phone numbers, and addresses for folks who did not opt out. As I mentioned in my email, schools can make a directory of basic contact information without permission. But out of, you know, being extra cautious, I wanted to make folks give folks the option to opt out. And we did have two families who opted out using my Google form. But after I took them off of the list, I sent out the information to the classes. I did keep the first name of the student on the list if they were using it as a Valentine's list or a birthday list, but it's only the first name of the student. It doesn't have any other information. So I thought that family doesn't want to be excluded from anything. They would have to go find that information elsewhere. And I only received two corrections to do over the weekend. And nobody said, geez, I missed the opt-out. Why did you do this? So that was my concern. And that's why I haven't done it for years.
Yeah.
I've been able to do it. And I'm thinking, oh, I want to do it. But then you just get antsy thinking, do these people really want to be part of it? Or do they miss an email? And nobody said they missed an email. And so far, everyone said, thank you so much for doing it.
Yeah, it's useful.
Yeah,
cool.
As a way to parent-to-parent communication. So if you're in grade K, you only get the grade K info. If you're in grade one, you only get the one info. If you have a one and a three, you get both.
Mm-hmm.
Teachers got everything. So I also made a spreadsheet that just has the whole school, all the grades, even the ones that opted out. I highlighted the ones that opted out. I said to teachers, don't share this. This is just for your convenience. I find it more convenient than trying to go into School Brains on my phone.
Yeah.
I pull up this file and I actually use it on the computer now more than School Brains because you don't have to go through different screens. You can just jump right to that spreadsheet. And so I hope you're finding it helpful. And again, it's a way for us to use technology to help people communicate more easily. In the area of curriculum instruction, iReady, we had a meeting about this on September 11th on our PD day. And teachers and I met together to talk about when we should do the iReady for the reading assessments. It's going to be done before the first report card and before the second report card. And then we'll have our conferences about the results at our first report card conference and at our second report card conference. There's a lot of nuance. There's a lot of things to consider when you look at a computer assessment that was given to a kindergartner or a first grader. So we thought it would be best if we were there to explain the results and see what we saw. And also teachers can also give context about other results that they've used to assess reading. But that's going to be our state reading assessment for this school year. And we're also talking about it. A couple of the teachers are interested in still using DIBELS, which is another reading assessment that the state says has their full backing. And so they are interested in that. And we're in discussion with those two teachers who are interested in doing it a little bit of a different way. And so then we talked about the timeline and the teachers helped set the timeline. We did it collaboratively. Our professional development day, September 11th, that was our early release day. We started, instead of having a lunch break, we actually moved things around a bit. And I went over the new teacher evaluation tool, which the superintendent, myself, and the NTA redid last year to make it easier for the teachers and the administration while still meeting the state law regarding teacher evaluation. They were happy about that, I believe, and I was able to explain how it worked and who their evaluator was. And then we had common planning time, and that was one of the requests for teachers, and it makes sense, start of the school year. Let's have common planning time. K-2 talked about field trips, also about assessment a bit. 3-5 talked about Veterans Day and also talked about field trips. And then I was able to get this field trip information to Mr. Deloy, the president of the PTO, and get the ball rolling so we can look at things out in the future and not do them, you know, so we can have the funding and the planning, the curriculum connections, those types of things. We all know that the more time you have before an event, the better it comes out. And then the last hour of the day was given so that teachers could complete their online trainings that we usually have at the start of the school year, so that folks had the ability to do that, or if they had already done it, they could do something else. And that concludes my report. If you have questions.
Can I just make a comment?
Sure.
I want to say that I think the open house was really well executed. I think it was very welcoming, and I loved that other staff besides your child's teacher was available to speak to as well. So I just thought it was very well done. So thank you.
Thank you for saying that. I appreciate it.
I wanted to just add that I've never seen Galileo perform more inspired to learn about current events than after yesterday's trip to the fire department.
That's nice.
To commemorate in fact, that's why I'm late tonight to the school committee. Real story, at dinner you would stop talking, and I wanted to look at information, you know, brought out my own educator. I'm like, oh my god, it's 6:55. So it was great to see him so inspired to have Ryan ask questions about CRA. So I appreciate you all making room for something that is so meaningful.
Wonderful. And, yeah, appreciate sharing that.
So moving to home facilities.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm sorry, I was having a moment there. You may have seen online the story of 9/11 with a gentleman, Brian Sweeney, who was a pilot who was on Flight 175. It's if you haven't seen it, it's worth seeking it. That morning I was the superintendent in DY and I got a phone call, and it was about that flight, and Mr. Sweeney was on the flight, and Mrs. Sweeney worked for me.
Oh,
and it was tragic, and yet it brought out the best in many of us at DY. And I had the great honor to speak at Mr. Sweeney's ceremony. It's just an amazing story. Part of the story is online. The other part is that Mr. Sweeney was a phenomenal football player at the University of Massachusetts. And he and his best friends, and they were both huge men when I met them, I thought I was like a little boy. They called them the Twin Towers.
Oh.
So the story has many levels.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where I just was, and I apologize, but it's just a great story. What's online is the message that he gave to his wife,
mm-hmm.
knowing, you know, he's a pilot, he knew what was going on probably very much more than anyone.
Yeah.
So
thank you.
And of course, that's the airplane that crashed in the middle of nowhere, and it didn't crash in the middle of nowhere because of the terrorists.
Right.
We can all imagine what was going on board. So let's move on. I already talked to you about the plumbing, and so I'm going to switch gears here, and I'm going to talk to you about supplies and materials, which in your survey, a couple of staff members had a comment about. We have gone, especially Mr. Andrews, has gone out of his way to make sure that every teacher has every supply and material that they need and want. One of the indicators for me how we're doing is a staff member who hadn't been here before had a conversation with me today. And I said, you know, you're getting what you want. And the comment was, I can't believe what you guys can do. So we're over that hump. So I just wanted you to know.
That's great. Yeah.
And the staff update is simple. We're all in place. Everything's working well.
And Tony, when you do these things, like you know, make sure the staff are either you order what they need or they're reimbursed or however you do it. Are you also, and I think the same thing for some of these other the common planning time. These were requests in the survey.
Yeah.
Are you naming them in your narrative with staff as you mentioned in the survey last year, or the feedback we got said this, so we have done this, just so you communicate out the changes you've made so that nobody is confused about or misses where you have actively strategically made change that has been requested by staff?
Probably not as, Madam Chair, through you, probably not as much as we could, but we haven't had a labor management meeting yet with the union.
Yeah.
That will come up at that. And none of the staff has seemed to be anything but affirmative. So I think they're getting it, but
I would say, it sounds to me like we're saying it every time we do something that's supportive of what is in the survey.
Okay.
I hear it when we are at staff meetings or on our PD day. So I do say it.
Yeah, PD day, I definitely mentioned.
Okay.
Yeah, and the September 11th one that you were, you know, it was a Monday, you weren't here, but, you know, I mentioned, you know, how we're making these decisions.
Yeah, I just think in my own experience, not as extensive as yours, Tony, but sometimes you do the thing and then either you staff come on and don't know where the thing came from, don't know the thing's been done, right? Or you can forget because we all do a million things as educators, right? And so you could forget, did we do that? You know, and I think, and also I kind of sometimes say to my own leaders, like, take the win, right?
Yeah.
And the win is for staff in that staff have been empowered, you know, to ask for some things and they got them. And you listened and were able to make some pivots. Everybody should take the win, and new staff coming on should know this is an environment where there's collaboration live and we can make these happen. Right. And so I have not communicated sometimes those things, and I've moved on with my life and to the peril of like some miscommunication.
It's a great reminder.
Yeah.
I can say that in our preschool workshops, I spent some time with all of the staff, faculty and support staff, and talked about the concern that staff members didn't get a dollar amount to spend each year. When I went to the superintendent's convention, I actually spoke to about a dozen of my colleagues and said, you know, how do you do materials and supplies? And it was kind of broken out a little bit more to, we give a building a whole bunch of cachet, and then if they run out, we see if we can get more, versus we give it to a staff member $250 and blah, blah, blah. And the ones that give money to each staff member had an interesting second concept. And when it's gone, it's gone. And so I said to the staff members that day, I don't want to do that. First of all, if you go out and spend something yourself, if you go out and buy something, you're going to pay tax, and then I can't pay the tax. So you're going to get stuck for the tax. That's not fair to you, but my hands are tied because I can't use public funds to pay taxes. Number two, if you go out and buy something, I'm probably going to be able to get it cheaper.
Bingo, that's what I was going to say.
Because I'm buying, you know, you're going to buy one pack of stickies and I'm buying a queso.
Yeah.
And then secondly, or thirdly rather, and this I think really rang true with the staff, the arbitrary figure of X may cover 60% of you. Some percentage of you may not need that much, and somebody else may need more. I said, just ask for it, and I'll tell you when you're getting crazy.
Yeah.
And that rang true within the last 2 weeks, because a staff member who was new to us came into a room that had been used by someone else, obviously. And they are very definitive about what kinds of things they want. They would be way over any allotment already for the school year because we had to bring that person up to speed, you know, up to a minimum. So I think everybody is happy. Mr. Andrews designed a bright yellow form that you can't miss, and teachers are turning it in. And, you know, the form is good because, like, one staff member, I happened to get it instead of Mr. Andrews, and I went through it, put a check on as we went through it. And there were several things that I went to the staff member and I said, you have to give me more information about this, because the last thing I want to do is spend money on something and then you get it and you go, oh, that's not what I wanted. So I think there were three things that staff member had asked for, and I said, you know, you need to give me information. A clear one, I'll tell you one that's really obvious to me, but wasn't to staff members. I want a bunch of stickies. Well, you know how many sizes they come in?
Yeah.
And colors? You know, do you want assorted? Do you want green? Do you want lined? You got to tell me something here. And so that's the process we're going through. And it's been very positive. The staff has been very responsive.
That's great.
So moving on to business.
Okay, Madam Chair, I want to tell you my code because it's, you know, a little weird. So you have two policies that you are looking at under old business.
These are second reading.
I'm sorry, I missed that.
No, that's okay.
I will change that. I apologize.
I'm gonna write in a minute.
I actually had an approval too on my notes. Sorry. When it's for approval, I'm putting the new policy first. When it's a first reading, I'm putting the current policy first.
Right. Yeah.
Okay? So that should help.
Okay.
So we've already discussed the substitute and the bullying policy during our last school committee meeting. So if no one has any changes, can I have a motion to approve said policies?
I'll make a motion to approve the two policies. GCG-R substitute pay for the second reading, and then the JICFB bullying policy.
I'll second the motion. Do I need a second to move them? Or
do we have to do them separately?
The motioner read the actual policy, so I believe that covers it. Typically, you would separate them, but
I second the policy, the two policies right there.
All in favor of both policies?
Aye.
Motion carries. Moving on to the long range reading.
Okay.
Madam Chair, whenever you would like to recognize me, I have a report on long range planning.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
Yeah. Okay. So at the end of last school committee meeting, a member of the committee, who shall go nameless unless she chooses to identify herself, came to me and made a suggestion that I speak with Mr. Ken Schundler, who was known to me as a resident here in town and had been for 18 years a member of a school board, as it's called in New Jersey, in a community not unlike ours. And Mr. Schundler has given me permission to use his name this evening. So based on the recommendation, I spoke with him for quite an extensive period of time. He was the president, which is the chair of our school committee, is the president of their school board. Many years, I believe it was 12. And they are, he lived in a community of approximately 1,000 residents who had one section of K through 8 with a class size of approximately 8 through 14. So they were really smaller than us when you think about it. His school committee considered sending students to larger regional surrounding districts many times. And one year actually sent 8th graders to the regional school district. Sound familiar?
I know, this is like creepily similar.
For one year when they had a really small number, he said he thinks the number was 5. He gave me a pro and con, which I will hopefully share with you accurately. The pro for keeping a local small school or small class sizes. All students are known to the administrations and staff and one another and the parents and guardians. It keeps students somewhat innocent for a longer period of time. It increases control of their development and maturation. It avoids some bullying, older behaviors and activities, which he named, which I won't. And he thought that small schools were one of the reasons that parents may have moved into the community with an expectation of a small school. And then in the middle of their children's education, if you change it, it may be something they didn't want. Like us, they had good academics. And noted that when the students from that school district moved on to the regional school district in high school, the students did very well with lots of students on the honor roll, high honor roll, and valedictorians and salutatorians. He also mentioned that small classes tend to avoid the cliques that you typically see develop in larger groups of students. The negatives were more activities and a bigger environment, more opportunities of a variety of nature, including social and athletic, et cetera. So his recommendation was to keep the pre-K, blend students when you have to, but make sure you're prepared to do so. He also noted emphatically that finances in his research, like mine, finances were not an issue. He said, it's really interesting because you think if you do away with a small school in a local environment, you're saving your local taxpayers money. But what you actually did was save money to the receiving district.
Yeah, right.
And that, of course, is never a goal. I mean, why would the hot school committee want to save another school committee money? I mean, you have your own issues. He actually did a mathematical survey several times and an analysis, and he decided that it would save their district somewhere between $300 and $500 per student per year, which in no way was worth losing the smallness.
Can I clarify, to close the school?
Yes.
Okay.
That is right. That would be to send students off out of their district.
Yeah,
but I think it's a fair assessment of something that we need to look at too. You know, like what we did for student cost, and that would be
Our per student cost in 2021, which was the last audited, was within $200 of Somerville, of Swampscott.
Yeah.
And we were lower.
Yeah.
So we're in the right ballpark. They also tried unsuccessfully to combine classes like we did. And he said that it was fine with everyone except the parents. he recommended something that I...
classes, but they ended up not doing it?
Yes. Yeah, he said there was a huge pushback. So my recommendations, which we've already begun, are to increase after school activities and hopefully get almost 100% participation by our student population in after school activities. In October, we will start a 3-session after school activity offering, one in, between October and the holidays, the break, winter break, and then two after winter break. We will continue to work towards making our school unique. For example, Mr. Andrews has the charge from me to communicate with Northeastern to make sure that we enhance our marine concepts in science and math. And we need to investigate how our students are doing at Swampscott Middle School and High School. At this point, a lot of what we have is anecdotal. You heard a parent report during our discussion in the spring how well our students are doing. We don't actually have the data that I'm comfortable with. I do know that we have a disproportionate number of valedictorians and salutatorians over the last decade, but I'm not sure that's indicative of the general quality as compared to the uniqueness of certain individual students. So we need to do a little better job, and we will. So that's my report.
Thank you for following us.
Very insightful. Thank you. And thank you to him as well for
spending so much time.
Yeah. One more thing, Madam Chair. He volunteered for a committee if you do, in fact, decide to have a community committee.
Oh, that's really good.
Really? I wanted to talk a little bit more about this, but I'm not sure if now is the time in long-range planning. Probably is. But a few things that I think might be useful for us to think about. One is and this came actually from Galileo too. So Galileo announced the card the other day. He's like, well, he's in fourth grade right now. And he said, I said, you've got 3 years left on this year at the Johnson School. And he said, no, I have 2 years because now sixth grade is always going to the middle school, right? And then I corrected him and he argued with me. That's a different part. and so I said, where did you hear that? And he said, well, that's what they're saying at school. Now they is always the kids. So
yeah.
So that was one thing. And then I have had a couple of people, like I mentioned before, approach me, on the street, in a good way, and just worry. One even voiced a concern about don't ever let the whole thing go, And that's never been a conversation any more than Galileo, going to the sixth grade and Swampscott Middle. So I think out loud, I want to get us to a point of saying what we are and what we defining what we are and aren't talking about in terms of short and long range planning, because there has never been a conversation about with anybody that I know of here publicly or in private of us becoming a regional school. And I wanted to mention that after your story, Tony, just because of that difference, right, in the story, even though it's a great emblematic story for us to listen to from your colleague. The second I just wanted to lift is that I do think while the amount of sixth graders, our current sixth graders in that are going to school in Swampscott is small, I do think having some vehicle for the kids and the parents, making sure at some point in time it makes sense in terms of
giving them enough time to kind of reflect. It does make sense for us to get their each individual opinion about with some really good calibrated questions that can get at some of our wonderings about how they're doing, right? But academically, socially, what's been hard? What hasn't been so hard? What's a major win? What is a huge loss, right? Those types of things. And I also wondered about asking, you know, talking about, it's hard to, I think commissioning a data study is hard because there's so many variables, but I do think it would be interesting to ask teachers in the middle school their thoughts, right? Not, you know, for a definitive statement, but just for some data to put into the mix about
from Swampscott,
just because they teach non-kids, right? And because we have heard lots of different statements about it's better to start now, it's better to wait, right? And so I kind of am interested in their voice too in this. So like primarily, we're going to be listening to folks in the hunt, period, because it's our community. But it would help to like if all the teachers say there's no difference, that's important data, for example. And they may not say that, but they may say that. So I just don't like, I was asking myself, like, what are the key constituents that I would want to hear from? So first, parents, then kids, then community members, and then educators. And that was just sort of like some thinking that I had. So I wanted to just voice that.
I mean, I think feedback is really helpful, but like any opportunity to get actual, like objective data is also really useful because without hard data, your mind just goes to maybe some outliers that might not, like you were saying about the valedictorian, it might not be predictive of the larger group as a whole.
Sure.
So, I mean, I think that they're all useful little bits of information, but we've asked a couple of times about student performance, and obviously much of the information is protected because it would be difficult to, for example, not that I'm asking for this, but if we were to want to know like how the sixth graders are doing academically over there, it'd be really hard with such a small data set.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not even sure how to go about doing that. And I totally appreciate your point that we need insight from all directions, how the students are doing here in their small group, how the students are doing in Swampscott.
Yeah.
It's just tough to get at those, like more, I'm just a data person.
Same.
And I love hearing people's insights, but I data, you know, so if anybody hasn't,
it's
for that as well.
Yeah, the part two is the investment of people, like what is your investment? What is your stake in the game? You know, which can be a tough thing to overcome. Like if I'm a teacher and I want more kids in my school, or, you know, I don't know that personal opinion about a particular student, you know, I just don't know. Everybody's going to have an opinion and their perspective on what should happen. And I think without the data, like that data on the finances, as much anonymous data as we can get for academic performance just in our own school. And I think the other thing that we're missing, and I don't know that we can actually obtain, is the social emotional, you know, without just overall, how are the children doing here now? You know, so I think, you know, it's great to have information, but I even think about myself to say, I don't know what's best for these kids. Seems like they're doing great based on what I'm seeing here. Financially, it makes more sense to do this. If there's not anything happening in social, like there's nothing to say one is better than the other. I think they're looking at two things, three, if we can get information about the social emotional stuff, and you know,
two things being
financial,
academic,
and academic performance, which I think sometimes if children are not succeeding academically, it's social emotional issues can be a part of that. So, you know, those two things are tied together.
And I also just want to make another point about what Mr. Parentage said the last time. And, you know, I repeat this myself in my own world of work, is operationally, it's working. You know, so what are you looking to gain by changing? You know, and I think the only thing that we can gain is to get better. That's just my perspective.
Operationally, what is, I forget
so,
that.
So basically, you know, we're a high performing school, and with the way that we were set up, and you know, and so
why change
something that works? Mm-hmm. And I'm not to say that
we don't
talk
about longer.
I'm talking about
longer term. Yeah.
Well,
not
well, only I'm talking about now and long term. Like
that's only academic based though.
But I think that
right?
Academic and the social is tied in. I don't know how much.
I have no
right.
idea.
But
you
know.
But and again, I think we're like kind of speaking for each other, repeating what you said. But like based on that, it's like we're well performing. Based on the data that we have for our school as a whole, and I'm assuming you mean the 79th percentile,
mm-hmm.
right? But that to me is like academically,
right?
And then I think we decided to make the changes we did because we thought it would maybe be best for that whole group, which was a very small group. But I agree with you. I think that those three things are going to be very telling. And it's like, how do you, you know, do you just ask general questions to the five kids?
Madam Chair, if I may, I'm concerned on many levels about where we're going. That doesn't mean we can't do it. I'm going to ask publicly that Mr. Andrews contact Mr. Kalikman and discuss how we figure this out. So, for example,
how we figure out an assessment.
How we figure out how our kids are doing. My mind's all over the place, but I'll try to organize it. Number one, I have no authority to ask a Swampscott teacher anything.
Right.
And so how would that go about?
Right.
I mean, we just can't do that.
Right.
Number two, I'm pretty sure we don't have the right to have their academic performance anymore because they're not our school. They're not under us. So, and the reason I think Jason and Kevin can figure it out is, you know, we can have data organized by them so that we only see bunches of it and we can't figure out who
averages
who.
Or yeah.
Everything's
mm-hmm.
grouped. And we have to inform the parents before we do that we're doing it, because if they don't want us to do it, they have the right to say no.
Right.
So that's, I mean, we're talking about a lot of work here, and that's okay. I love the concept of investment in the game that Michelle mentioned, because that's always in the back of my mind. When I ask, I always think about something that I learned eons ago. When person A tells you about person B, they actually tell you more about person B than person A. And the way I learned it, they used names, but I don't want to get into that gender thing. So I changed it. And that's true. Of the 1,000 things I could have observed today, why do I remember the ones I remember? And that's about me.
Right.
It's not about what I observed.
Right.
So when you ask somebody a question, you always have to think about the context.
Yes.
And that's going to be hard to figure out. So here's my bottom line. Number one, we know we're doing that well academic. Number two, with rare exceptions, I have not heard, and I know Mr. Andrews has not heard, maybe you have, of students who left our sixth grade or our fifth grade and have floundered at the middle school in Swampscott. If anything, I hear from parents, gee, the kid loves it over there. They're doing great. Now, whether doing great means social, academic, athletic, I don't know. So again, it's back to the concept of if operationally we've been pretty much on the on target, what are we going to change and why?
Can I just add two more things? You know, with the I'll say that certainly there are some changes and challenges that come when you go from little school to bigger school academically and socially, and you know, just being a mom and talking with other parents, you know, I hear both sides of the good and the bad and everything in between, but I don't know that that necessarily translates to that that would be any different if they went a year before or a year after.
That's right.
So that's one thing that just came to my mind. And then the only other thing I want to say is that I get questions several times a week, my own son included, about what's going to happen next year.
Yeah, exactly.
And I just keep telling people, like, we're being very transparent. It's going to be on the, you know, it's going to be on the agenda when we're focusing and talking about that. And so come to the meetings, you know, and I'm just really encouraging, you know, just, and it's not even always necessarily fifth grade parents. Like,
right.
It's just people, oh, so what's going to happen?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Even people that don't have kids at the school, so I just tell them we're talking about it. It's on that, so
that's some stress. Yeah.
So should we put it on the agenda in the future? Just knowing that we should talk about it maybe in October.
Yeah,
the guidelines.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. We have like certain checkpoints when we're going to get checked in on the
teachers. Yeah.
And yeah.
So
just
for them,
our
priority
would be
not
great.
Yeah.
Or
like
we haven't
talked
about
it. Yeah.
Refresh paper.
Yeah,
I know we have.
I think it was October 10th.
October 10th. Okay, that's what I thought.
You know,
Yeah.
Long
term planning. That's a good
word. I think that we're all on the same page that we're just trying, you know, we're trying to do what's best for our kids.
Yeah.
And I think we want them to be happy. We want them to succeed.
Yeah.
And it is like hard when you have such a small group. We want answers, but we want to be respectful and
right.
of privacy, but we also want answers, but we also don't want to like poke the bear if the bear is sleeping. Like, you know, it's sort of like, I think, I was just thinking more about the questions. I think what Mr. Tarantazzi said in terms of having Mr. Andrews and Mr. Couchman talk, I think makes sense. But like, for me, I'm like, how do we get some answers without it having to be like, so personal?
Yeah.
You know, just very generalized questions. And maybe, I don't know, it's like you want to do the work and actually get the answers you're looking for. So,
yeah. But we might not get.
I'm sorry. What I meant by that was like, when I think of generalized questions, I don't mean like having people give us the specifics of their like daily interactions. I just mean more. Are you happy? Are you unhappy? Like, just get a general, like, almost like a temperature check.
But then I'm going to reiterate that thing, are you happy? Are you not happy? I don't know if they went, like, if you were suggesting to ask the sixth graders,
right?
I don't know if that would have been different if they were in the seventh grade.
Exactly.
Grade
so it's like,
grade.
You would have poked the bear here,
right?
But because we made this big decision for the small group, and then it's like, what do you even do with it, right? If, depending on what they are, because the truth is, it's where are we? It's only been a couple of weeks.
Right.
Yeah.
And it's and they everybody needs time to adjust.
Well, that's why
I
said
in
the year. But I guess I disagree on some of the points. Let me clarify some things. I wasn't saying that, you know, I understand the difficulty in the sample size. What I was talking about teachers, and yes, we have no jurisdiction, this is me wondering, could we ever get permission? Would it be okay to ask teachers in general, not about this experience, but in general, do they ever wish that they had another year? And ask it in a way that we could titrate out the ones that might be answering because we need more kids in our schools. I don't think every teacher would answer. Think Machiavellian. If I answer it this way, it's because we need more kids. And we know that's out there. We know that's out there. So we know we have to be wary of that. I also, no information line is sacrosanct where I'm looking for information. I want lots of data in different ways from different sources. And then if I am the decider, and we are in this, on this committee, then there's
solace in the fact that we get to decide in whatever way we think is best, right? It's not like, well, you know, as a school superintendent, I have to make decisions based on the academic data, the parent data, the school, you know, and whereas here, it's different, this type of decision. So then that makes me crave different types of data. So that's why I, and to be honest, I've always been interested in that before this ever became a thing at Swampscott, because as an educator, it is a middle school starting in fifth grade or sixth grade is not that strange to me. But a middle school that's for two towns of students where one town starts 2 years after, does those 2 years in an upper elementary and then goes in, and there's another group that starts at a different, at the same time, but in a middle school. That is, I'm sure you've seen that before, but I have never seen that before in my travels. Mm-hmm. And so I've always had a question mark about who's getting the game there. And I honestly don't know the answer. My wife and I have gone round and round, and I will tell you my own opinion as an educator has changed since we first started these conversations. So, you know, so I've been open and informed about this. I have wonderings about the fifth grade at one point. I no longer have wonderings about that, provided it, you know, everything else works for them. And I would get information that I would want to consider from a general asking of teachers, again, about the last arc of years, not about this particular year. On these students themselves, we did not have the benefit of everyone having tried this before to make a decision about the sixth graders that are over there now. But we do now have that to talk about what this small fifth grade class is going to do next year. And I think, like, I know we can't ask about academic data, but except for one area, we can ask parents if they're willing to share their opinion about how their students have done academically, right? And again, they're parents, right? Not necessarily educators. One of them is, at least. But I think asking them, you know, how do you think it's gone, with some good questions that, like, we can get from people who have try to elicit unbiased answers, right? We could get some sense of that from them, and as well as the students themselves. And again, that pile of data would just be another data point for us to consider as we make a decision about the current fifth graders, right? Going to sixth grade. And then deciding whether or not we're gonna go down, you know, because our current fourth grade has a lot of kids. It's a different, you know, it's a totally different thing in terms of numbers. So I imagine that we're gonna be probably at that point deciding, are we gonna go forward with anything more long-term, or say no, as we are investing in some blended learning, right? So that hopefully that better explains kind of where I was at. So some of that is similar to the conversation. Yeah. Some of this feels different, yeah. You know, there.
So Madam Chair, several thoughts. Number one, I totally agree, let's get a broad picture of students from Nahant at Swampscott Middle School and High School, not a unique, very tiny group. That's what I was thinking of and probably didn't articulate it well enough.
All right.
Because the current sixth grade at Swampscott Middle School was in fact a unique group of students in a variety of ways. Something that came to mind as you all were eloquently speaking is one of the things that we are probably not thinking of as much as we should is that our students are going into a changing environment, not a static one. Swampscott Middle School is not what it was 2 years ago or 3 years ago. They have gone very hard on a welcoming environment. The current administration has put a lot of effort into it. And our juniors and seniors in high school went into a very different Swampscott Middle School than it is now. It just, I don't know what that means. It just popped into my head because we're talking as if it's kind of a place, and it's not a place. It's organic. It changes. Perhaps it would be helpful if the school committee expressed a default position eventually.
Yeah.
if nothing changes, we will do this. I'm just thinking out loud. You may not want to do it, but we've always been a pre-K-6. We're going to be a pre-K-6 unless, so that people know what your default is. It's just a thought, a random thought. No matter when the Nahant students go to Swampscott, they're going to be a unique entry point because all their kids are going to be together from kindergarten when the new school opens.
Exactly.
It's not a factor.
Right. Yeah, that's a good point. Right?
It's not a factor. It doesn't matter if they go in fourth grade, fifth grade, sixth grade, or seventh grade. They're going to be coming into a school where everybody's been together for years.
Another perspective I heard was that it was like such a fun thing for both schools to merge. You know, like to go
at the newbies
come. At the newbies come, yeah.
Yeah,
and like meet new people, and
yeah.
It's like an
yeah.
exciting thing.
Yeah,
too.
Yeah.
So.
Again, I just thought of that when you were talking. I said, wait a minute.
Yeah.
The choice in merging is a temporary one.
Right.
Right? Am I correct? Because that's an excellent point, Madam Chair, for two reasons. One, I believe they're going to have the room in the new elementary school. Number two, they're going to be renovating the middle school, and if they renovate smaller, it'll be a lot cheaper. Yeah. So,
estimated to be done next fall is the new school, is that right?
That seems.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah,
I'm not
that
sure.
Was the original target.
Yeah.
Then I have a story because it's fascinating.
You always have stories.
I always have stories. When you've lived as long as I have, you always have stories. I was speaking to a parent who had multiple children and they moved. And their children started in a new school. One of their children was quiet, unhappy, miserable for a particularly long period of time. The other children were happy and gregarious and outgoing for almost forever. So they moved, they entered the new school. And I was talking to this parent, and they said to me, I didn't know, I just thought I knew. The quiet, unhappy one who had few friends leap forward into this new environment and now has friends unlike this student ever had before in the school they grew up in. Whereas the gregarious ones are not happy. They're quiet and they're having difficult times making friends. So it just reminded me of the old adage that we don't know, we just think we know.
Right?
It was just, and it was perfect. It literally happened within the last week of my conversation with this person. And they said to me, go figure. And it's kind of amazing.
Yeah, there's no easy solution.
No.
Really is not. But we're going to have to start really making a decision.
Zeroing in on it.
And like what you said about some default, I think that's where I started. And not, I think there are some things now we know we are not going to do. And I think as soon as we can sort of align and message those, it might, you know, there might be some anxiety that we could well, and I think that might be a good thing.
Like we're not sitting in fifth grade.
Well, I mean, it go, like we're not becoming a regional school. Like I've had to
right. yeah.
ask that.
Yeah.
So no, that's not
okay.
I think if we know,
right.
you know, we didn't send the fifth grade this year. And so we're going to look at how that worked out, but it's looking good, I think, from what we've seen so far. So I think we're getting close to being able to say that as well, barring anything that we don't see. So yeah, I do think those types of things. So then it also helps hone in on what we do actually need to take up at this meeting and also give parents and community members plenty of time, like we've been saying out in the world, to like come to the meetings and give comment, right? And that'll also help us gauge like when and if we need to have some kind of a more public forum where there's a discussion.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
because other than returning to a pre-K-6, which everyone knew of, expected, historically experienced, it would be a broad community decision. You know, obviously led by you.
Right, yeah.
But, you know, you'd be changing the nature of the community in a not insignificant way. You know, it's interesting. If you chose that map that way, for one more year, it'd be a little tiny group of kids.
Yeah.
But then the year after that,
exactly.
Bang.
Bang, right, exactly.
Like, you're talking about a huge, you know.
Oh,
and,
right
and
now,
very,
19.
And $19.
Yeah.
And, yeah, I think, yeah.
And a lot of our reasons for making the move are not true for the current fourth graders.
That's right.
Right?
Correct.
So there's...
Or perhaps even the current fifth grade.
Right. Well, I'm thinking the current fourth grade, and again, fourth grade, we don't know what's going to happen in a couple years,
right,
or even
right.
a year, right? It's, they're half boys and half girls,
yeah.
just about, I think.
Yep.
They, and there's a lot of them. They, only one that I know of started a charter school this year.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I think, you know, that's, those are all different than some of the trajectory that we saw in the two prior classes. So
mm-hmm.
then if we did something there would have to be some different reasoning, which is why I kind of was thinking about those other data points, because I think those are going to help either make that a discussion or it's not going to be a discussion, you know?
So how do we get those data points? Do we want to have like a community-wide discussion over questions?
Then we envision that.
My fear with the community discussion is I don't want people to think that they are ignored when we don't go with what they have said, because again, you know, part of our function here is to hear community correspondence, but this is such a perspective to, in my opinion, that people can have different ones, and you know, when you talk to students, they could be having a really bad day. I hate middle school. I hate this. I hate that. I hate it. Next day, I'm so afraid.
Yeah.
Oh,
they're
hormonal.
Yeah.
And you know, that's where I'm data driven, because that to me is.
Madam Chair, a thought for your consideration as committee is, should the decision, should the intentions of the school committee be set prior to that community discussion?
Intention.
Because that's typically how a hearing is done. Typically, it doesn't matter if it's federal, international, or small. An intention is stated, and then give us your input. Very rarely is a general input sought on an open-ended question, because what happens is you get so many different things. Now, you may choose to do it that way. That's totally your decision. It's just, it may focus that conversation with the community if the school committee's intention was X.
Can I make sure I understand you? So if we get to a point where we say, all right, by intention, you mean plan, or
yes.
what the direction we're leading in. So our direction is that, you know, things are going well and we're going to keep the sixth graders here. And then you hear feedback from the community about that plan.
Yes.
How is that different, though, than what Michelle is pointing out, that then if a bunch of people come and say that they don't agree with that, how is that? And then you don't change your plan. Like what? I'm just trying to understand the process of like, what's the point
sure.
of listening?
Every public meeting I have ever taken part in, whether it be a financial one or a new school or something, prior to the public meeting, there is a goal, an intention, a plan, a tentative arrangement, a budget, a tentative budget. You don't go with a blank sheet of paper and okay. say, okay, we have no idea what we're going to do. Tell me what you want. Because it's all, it, then it gets harder to make a decision than easier.
But I think the situation is different than both of those scenarios because we're not a blank slate.
Right. I was just
saying. And we're also, I would not open up any community forum if we are going to keep the sixth grade here long term. That is the status quo.
Yeah.
We moved some kids last year in May this year. Don't know May. Depending on the environment, our research, etc. If that makes sense, because of a small class size, social emotionalness of a small class size, etc. Right. I think in the for me, if we are wondering whether there is a world where the sixth grade. It may be better for to make a longer term for the sixth grade, then it doesn't make sense to talk about this year and then raise the whole thing again and talk about the future, right? And if there's no temperature for this and we do want to do it on a year by year basis based on class size, then I kind of think we just need to do that, right? And we're waiting until we can get some data, right? I think the only time that we need a public forum to have discussion is if we're going to make a very big change to Swampscott, which would be sending the sixth grade permanently over to Swampscott. And we don't even know if we can do that. Right?
Exactly.
Forever. So we're not, that's the only place I could see us getting, having like a public forum about this.
I agree with you. I was sitting here thinking if together as a committee, we evaluate the things that we want to look at and if determined by vote that what the temperature is to take them or not, or to permanently move or not, and if it's going to be that we vote to keep the sixth grade here, then why would we need a discussion?
So personally for me, I do not feel that it should absolutely be that they stay here for me. So this was something that I had been thinking, like I've told you guys, this is something I've been thinking about for a long time.
Right.
And I think that the class size sparked us to do it. However we landed there, we landed there. But I personally wouldn't feel comfortable and happy just assuming that it's a given that it's always going to stay that way without investigating how it's going this year and looking more into it as a committee.
As a committee, if we look into that information,
yes,
and determine that by vote,
whatever decision we make,
we're not going to change, then
right.
I don't know
right.
that we need to have yep.
exactly
oh, everybody else.
Yeah.
Yes.
Correct.
Okay.
Yep.
That's so I think we're all saying the same
yep.
thing.
Yes.
Okay.
In
yes.
In terms of
absolutely.
Process.
Yes.
Yeah.
But here's my question. For this incoming grade
right.
six,
yeah.
we want to treat it the same way that we did last year's grade six in terms of feedback from the families that are direct. Well, we didn't ask.
We didn't ask.
No, we
were
going to do the same thing that,
yeah.
but again, to my point, like, this is all perspective. And so, for these families, if you have a 2 to 3, I guess what I'm saying,
and put out earlier
yes.
that we're going to talk
yes,
about this
yes,
and
yes,
let
yes.
them come to
yes,
the meeting
yes,
and
like,
give
yes,
them yes, that's all I'm saying
yes,
that's
yes.
and
give
yes,
them
yes.
The because we're
yeah.
still stuck
yes.
in the forum piece. Is that what you're trying to say? Like
yeah
we have been clear about our planning.
Right.
We have a plan in terms
right.
of when we're going to discuss what. We have deadlines
yes.
that
yes.
we're going to work
yep.
for.
And I've requested
and,
that we look at potentially some other data.
And
yes.
our hope is that, of course, at any time, if families want to join and have a and have their community,
but
it would be
exactly.
at that time.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. I agree with that.
Yes.
Yes.
And yeah. And
this is,
so
I think,
the,
why we're really trying
yeah.
to
But the October 10th thing is a meeting that we're going to be discussing a lot of things, and that would be their opportunity,
yeah.
opportunity to come in and other times
yeah.
after that
yes.
to to offer their perspective and all of that. And I guess I'm not saying I'm not interested in their perspective, but
of course.
Also that, you know, decision making has to
come from, of course, it's set on our plan, like December 9th decision on rising sixth grade class.
Right. Mm-hmm. But earlier, you know, to again, like, offer your input on your perspective, we will be discussing them at this point.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Couple things. While we were meeting, I did check, and the agenda is on the Johnson, it's always on the Johnson School website. Mm-hmm. So if people are wondering, like, is this going to be discussed? You can tell them that our agenda is always posted. Mm-hmm. And I double-checked it.
I know
for
the town
For every meeting.
Oh.
Our agenda is always public.
Yeah.
So people know that we're going to be public.
Yeah.
But just one thing, and it kind of came up at the end of last meeting. So I think there's, like, kind of three potential possibilities. Because at the beginning of the year, when I was putting together this timeline, I was under the impression, and I think this is what you're saying, Beth, is that, like, we're going to make a decision for this rising sixth grade class, and it'll fuel us to, and provide us with the information to make a decision about long-term planning. But I think that what we discussed is that they're different, because the class still is very small, and we may not be ready to, you know, really, you know, close the conversation about long-term planning because it's such a huge decision. So one possibility is everything stays the same for both this next year and then in the future, but we might not know that by middle or even at the end of this year. And another possibility is, you know, that the next year's sixth grade class goes, but long-term we actually stay K through six. Mm-hmm. And then last possibility is the students stay, but ultimately with bigger conversations, the decision is made in the future, because I think we all decided that we might not be ready to make those decisions together.
You're absolutely right. We have so much to do here. Finding a superintendent focused on, like, long term.
But I do remember that conversation. And that's important, but in FY24, which is this year, we're going to be deciding about the FY25 sixth grade, right? Mm-hmm. The small fifth grade, right?
Yes.
Okay. In FY25, which is next year, while that sixth grade is potentially at Swampscott Middle School, right? We then could decide about the long term either way, right? But I don't think I see, it does not be, to Liana's point, it doesn't make sense to then bring the sixth grade back here and then further down the line talk about long-term implications. I think that this is bringing up our consideration now, right? Mm-hmm. And so we could decide the long-term decision next year, yes, right? But I think it either we make the decision next year or we don't. We make the decision to change this, have a community forum, long-term sixth grade goes to Swampscott, or we make the decision to not do that, keep the sixth grade here, and move on.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think so too.
And I think
that puts a lot of the onus on us. I mean, that's putting a lot of the work on us, but I think we're all gonna work so thoroughly. Yes.
I mean, I wanted to decide all this until I was here. But that doesn't make sense.
No.
She wanted to decide on this why we were here.
Okay.
I know. Okay.
So moving on to superintendent search.
It's to be out of here.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Members of the committee, in your packet labeled 7D is my humble attempt at a resignation letter.
It was a lovely day.
Thank you.
It was the worst part of my day.
I didn't read it. It
was very lovely.
Oh, do you want me to read it into the record? Or?
Yes, please.
Okay. So it's dated today. Dear Chair Karras and members of the Nahant School Committee, please accept this correspondence as my notice to resign for the purpose of retirement again. from the position of part-time superintendent of the Nahant Public Schools, effective June 30th, 2024. Thank you, and those members of the Nahant School Committee who preceded you, for this wonderful opportunity. It has been a pleasure to work with and for you. This position has provided me with the opportunity to work with so many wonderful people, all focused on providing the youth of Nahant the quality education while also addressing their social, emotional, and physical needs. The Johnson Elementary School staff members have been and continue to be excellent. The staff members are the artists of our business. They are always ready to pitch in to solve a problem, help a student or a family, and suggest an improvement. They have provided outstanding support for our work. The two administrators and assistants who work with me represent the best of our business. The officials of the town of Nahant have been and are supportive, communicative, and easy to work with. The parents and guardians and all community members are supportive of the Johnson Elementary School and, of course, the students and staff. It'd be better if I could spell the word Johnson. I will always be grateful for the opportunity provided by the Nahant School Committee to work in and become familiar with the town of Nahant, the Johnson Elementary School, and most of all, the people who live and work in Nahant. Working here has and continues to be a pleasure. Thank you.
Thanks, Tony. Thank you. So moving on to the superintendent's search process, I'm wondering, did we have an opportunity to attend the webinar that was held last Friday?
No, I wanted to, and I said no.
I read your slide.
I
requested the report.
Okay, awesome.
So did you attend it by any chance?
I did. Great. So there's a lot of work to be done. It was very well done, and MASC did a very, very good job. It was very intense, and I left freaking out in that webinar, like, oh my God, we've got to move. So their advice was work backwards in terms of your timeline.
Yeah.
So we want a superintendent in place July 1. We have to have an agreement in place 90 days prior.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, contractually. So that puts us into an offer extended in March.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I got out of that.
Six months from now.
Yeah. And there are 5 different pages that they outline. And I really think it would be good services to help us with
this
process.
I thought that was the plan. We're going to look to them
to help us.
Yeah.
So I know we've given a few proposals out there, but after what I've heard, I think it will probably serve us the best.
Okay.
But I don't know what that means.
Sure. I have shared with the chair a packet of information from the MASC executive search process. And I can copy this again and send it to you all.
I have a copy from previous.
So
yes.
There's a this brochure, I believe. Did I send it to all? No?
I got it.
Oh, you may have gotten it at a workshop.
Yeah.
Okay. So there's basically 2 things. One is administrative support. And that would be that if the school committee chose to do its own interviews and its own screening, they would, MASC would help you design an advertisement and give you a technical support. There would be no cost to you.
Technical support.
Something popped up. You wanted the school committee wanted to know the process. Be concrete. Give you a concrete example. Which of your interviews could be in the executive section, and which had to be public?
Yeah. Okay.
That's
okay.
A technical question.
Okay.
They would.
Do we interview publicly? Like the town assistant when they did the TA interviews?
Well, I can give you technical assistance right now. Your first round can be in the executive session.
Yeah.
After your first round, So let's say you had 10 applicants, you chose to interview five. The first time you interview, that could be executive. You whittle it down to three, that has to be public. My interview with Mahan was public.
Do people know? Most of our meetings were public.
Yes. Very few, it was a town session. It was a town hall.
And that's always like after I'm
No, it's a separate meeting.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I was going to say, I'm like, this is not going to work.
And you say, or, talk, so they do that. They do an advertisement for the position?
My office would do the advertisement for you.
Okay.
Chris would do it. Or you could hire them to do the search.
Yeah.
And in that case, they come in, they write the ad, they put the ad in the paper. They go through the paper review initially. They actually have an individual who would be at the interviews with you, herding people in and out. And I don't know if we have that cost or they're going to.
I don't think we have that cost.
I don't
that,
believe
and
so.
That's where I'm.
Yeah. So.
We need help.
Yes.
Madam Chair, I apologize. On June 15, 2023, I did get a quote.
$10,500. Oh, he told us.
Yes,
he
did.
By the way, let's do it.
I think we have the budget to do that.
Do we have the budget?
That's my job.
Okay.
If that's what you want to do.
Do we have the budget to do it?
I'll find, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Short answer, yes.
Okay,
yes.
Thank you.
No, we need some assistance here.
Yeah.
In terms of keeping us on track, this is a 5-phase process.
And we're all volunteers, like we can help.
Right.
Yeah,
we all have other very stressful.
So, Madam Chair, do you not
jobs?
Okay,
multiple jobs.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I can.
You have his email. I have it. I'll send it to you. No problem. And you're getting in nice and early. Well,
I don't know if
early for July 1st, 2024, but the insanity that's been happening around us. The Marblehead interim superintendent was posted today.
Oh.
And there are at least 10 superintendencies in eastern Massachusetts that have been vacated within the last 6 months.
Any pipeline?
No. Also, Madam Chair, with your permission, I'd be happy to communicate with the executive director of MASS and simply say, you know, part time, if you know of anything, throw it our way.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
It is a unique position.
Yeah.
Yes, unique is the term.
Yeah. Oh, what? Oh, oh you.
It is a really unique.
And if you'd like me to negotiate with Grant for about 10-5, I could probably get it down a little.
We know
you
said.
You know,
I'm really good at that.
Because we're so small, but it just, we really want to do this right.
Yes,
right? Yes,
yeah, yes,
we
it
do.
Is.
Yeah.
But we can get the white glove for 8,000. Let's get it for 8,000.
Right.
Yeah.
Agreed.
Or
absolutely. And the only other question I had too, just because it's my first go around with a town position, is our town administrator, town hall involved in any way? Strictly our purview.
Let me give you the notes that I took the lead.
So we should set up the public. Okay. The search committee.
Within our committee?
No.
Oh.
So the search committee, we can have up to, we can have a quorum of school committees. I think we can have up to, would that be two of us? And then we can invite other members from the committee.
Mm-hmm.
Great.
That's good.
Great.
And I think we should do that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
smart.
Yeah.
That would be fantastic.
Mm-hmm. Yes, because it shouldn't all be us.
No.
And it also like is very good to include the staff.
Yes, absolutely. Yes, absolutely. Yeah. And actually, yeah, I have some thoughts about one. Okay. I would like to reach out to them.
how many committee members can there be?
So on
no, not ours, like for this committee.
Oh. So 9 to 13, which is, you know, I would say probably a larger school district.
Yeah.
So we would want to be on the smaller side.
Yeah. Okay.
Madam Chair, if I could be so bold as to not get involved with my own
yes.
I would consider, if I were the chair of the school committee, speaking with Glenn or one of the other field reps about every level of decision,
of course,
prior to even talking about it with your colleagues.
Okay.
So, for example, some people think it's not a good idea to put staff members on the search committee.
Of the current staff.
I
agree.
Yes.
I think probably.
Yeah. Others think it's
retired.
Yeah,
or something.
It's not a bad idea.
Yeah.
So you know, you get there, and that changes. You know.
Interesting.
Do you?
I do too. I really think there should be.
The only reason that I could say that I would be in agreement is that for whatever reason a staff member didn't select the candidate that you selected, then there's this sort of, I don't know, an approval of that person initially and that person ultimately.
But what if the school committee like makes some selections and then have this other committee sort of, I don't know. I think
it's the search committee that hires the person.
That's why I think your first conversation.
Oh, so yes, okay. So that I can.
It actually is the other way around. The selection committee would select a number,
right?
Never one,
right? Yeah,
and
right.
Then you
select the school
and you
committee.
Make the final determination.
That's why I think it's
okay.
Safe to have.
Oh, okay.
Staff. I mean, when we search for a major role, in a school, I mean, this is a superintendent search, but everyone gets to weigh in. None of them make the decision, though. I do.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. One of the things I would do as a superintendent when I had, you know, a interview team of 20 people. And it is different because the superintendent is the only person in this school district or any school district who works directly for you.
Okay, right.
Everyone else would work for the superintendent.
Right.
So we had an actual printed statement that this committee will be recommending to the superintendent a number of applicants that meet this committee's minimum requirements for doing a successful job. And then the number would be 2, 3, 4, whatever. Typically no more than 4. The second part of that statement would be, and then this was always given by the director of personnel. The director of personnel would like to remind you that the ultimate decision about hiring is the authority of the superintendent of schools and only the superintendent of schools. And your recommendation is expected to be a number of individuals who, if the superintendent chose that person, you believe that you could live with that decision. I mean, it wasn't live with. But in some way frame it so that they understand they're not making the decision. Because oftentimes, well, whoever is on that committee, it's rarely unanimous. So somebody's going to get hired that somebody on that committee doesn't like.
Yeah. Or wasn't their first choice.
Yeah.
I know. I guess just to my point was, if it's a staff member, to me, that's more important to them.
Yeah.
Than somebody who doesn't have to.
Right, yeah.
Okay, but let's do it this way. In the scheme of the organizational structure of a school, district, or a school as small as ours, the superintendent has more important interaction with the town manager, the police chief, and the fire chief than line staff, who the principal really has the interaction.
Yep. I guess I'm just so used to you being
really
around.
Okay.
No, I think you're very hands-on in it with the
you know that's the best throw.
Right. You're tough at all.
But one thing that we should do though, as you know, we go back home and think between now and then, that we should start.
I thought that little
thing.
Okay. It was
sorry. Is it like a
another
book?
No, I think the same one. Beth, take care of it. She
and is it a crocodile? What is it?
We can't go.
Sorry for deflecting there. We should really start thinking about the expectations and the success factors of what we envision as superintendent.
Mm-hmm. So you sent those slides and all of the things that you described are listed in phase one.
Yeah.
And then I was wondering if there was an old your job description, Tony.
I have asked.
Okay, that would be helpful, I think. In this way, we can.
I sent several to the chair.
Okay,
yeah,
great.
Tony doesn't have, but he said he's.
Okay. So I think we would just have to do a little bit on the mark for phase one.
Yeah, if I may again, Glenn has 50 of them.
I can't wait to meet
them. He's been doing it a lot.
He's been around forever.
Yeah.
I think he will help us tremendously.
Yes.
So do we need
or to... he may, in fact, delegate it to one of the other field reps, all of whom I've known Mr. Hardy for 25 years, and other people who work now for them. One has been the... the MASC school committee member of the year in past year. So all very, very highly skilled and very knowledgeable people. And they do it regularly, you know, so they're
does he know a lot about have you talked to him about our school committee in the hall?
No.
That's not my job.
Do we need to take a vote to are you taking care of the contract stuff with MASC or that would be Taddy? Okay, so then do we need to vote to allow you to authority to?
I would recommend that the chair speaks with Glenn and
okay.
gets a number.
Okay.
Tell Glenn that Tony thinks the number's too high for a small team.
Okay.
All right.
So the next
has to negotiate.
The next meeting, we should have done our homework for phase one,
and then
the job description, or maybe the next meeting after the next meeting. So that gives us two meetings to do our homework.
Let me have a conversation
okay.
with fun.
Yeah.
I would love it if we could actually talk to all of us in some shape or form. See if we
can
do it.
Okay.
And then
set up a Zoom into the next meeting?
Sure.
Yeah, set up a Zoom with Glenn at the next meeting.
Yeah, I would love that. Everyone can hear that.
Yeah,
that's
down
the line.
Okay.
So that, you know, we can all say, okay, this is going to be our homework assignment. Phase one, ABC.
A Zoom during our meeting.
Because you never
I know, just making sure.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so let's move on then to new business because we have many more policies.
You sure do. I mean, I'm sorry.
So.
Probably you spend your summer vacation.
So, Mr. Parentale, do we just read these that we read them and just if anybody has any questions?
Madam Chair, I'm flexible. Let me give me a couple of minutes on each one.
Sure.
Okay. The current non-discrimination policy, as you can tell, is different than the new draft file AC, which is the non-discrimination policy, including harassment and retaliation. That has newer legal definitions.
Can I ask a question? No, because there is some similar language.
Yeah.
So the idea is that we won't actually have this first. They're not two separate policies.
No, they're not.
Yeah, it's that the new policy would be the non-discrimination policy, including harassment.
That is correct. Okay. Whenever you have a current and new, yes. The new takes place of the current. So this brings the concept of discrimination policy consistent with mass general law and federal civil rights acts. And the acts of 2022, you're going to see that a lot. In 2022, the legislature passed a lot of new laws that we have to come into consistency with. So this is one of those that if you want to change some of the grammar, you want to change V to Do, fine, but I wouldn't change very much of it. Okay, so that's AC.
Sorry, but with the how it says new draft. We're giving you feedback on how it's worded.
If you want.
Okay.
Sure.
The blanks are because we put them on.
Yep. Oh. Yes. The file AC-R is new.
What's the difference between new
drafts? Meaning we've never had this policy.
That's correct.
But how is it different from file AC that says new draft?
I had a question about that. I thought it was the same.
It's not the same.
No, it's definitely not the same, but are they not because they're both AC?
And they both are non-discrimination policy, including arrest and retaliation.
Yes, that's right.
Okay, so the R means reference in my head. So this policy further defines AC.
Okay.
And we don't have it. So, for example, this tells you what we're going to do. We will promptly respond.
Right. Is there, can we rename that so it's more clear, or are the names set in stone?
They're set in stone. This is the MASC policy naming.
So in the MASC, they're both named non-discrimination policy, including harassment and retaliation. Just one has an R.
Yes.
Okay.
Why is race on the new draft AC? Why does race have an asterisk? I couldn't find a corresponding asterisk. Explain mine.
I'm sorry, say that again.
On the one that says new draft file AC, if second paragraph, second sentence, second line, it says race with an asterisk. And there's no like corresponding asterisk.
I have no idea.
Oh, wait, nope, there is under legal references. Okay, great.
Yeah, it's
yep,
right there.
There it is. Yep. Race to include traits historically associated with race.
Yep.
Including without women. That's brand new. That's part of the 2022.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
You're looking at ACR.
And then it's an ACR. What is this?
Oh, I don't have something.
So that's two of them.
No, Michelle's looking at one that has that top thing.
That has draft.
Draft.
New AC draft, but this one is the new one because this is MASC.
Right. This is the one.
2022. So I have one that doesn't have anything. It's just file ACR, the non-discrimination policy.
I have that. Yeah. Yep.
That's because we don't have that in our book.
Yeah.
It's further along than
you said.
Oh, okay.
So this one, the new draft ACR, is replacing the ACR that we have. We do have it if it's numbered.
Are you on B? Michelle?
She's on ACR. ACR, I don't think you have the policy, period.
Oh, here it is right here. So there's three that say non-discrimination policy,
right,
including harassment.
Yes.
Okay.
Three of them. So this is correct. Right.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay. But
right,
that's also labeled case.
Yes.
Exactly.
Let's do it by the letters. That may be easier.
So the
AC we have,
yes,
and there's a new draft.
Okay.
AC-R, there's a new draft we don't have. ACAB, we have, but it's now being retitled by the attorneys to sexual harassment.
So, but how many policies are we ultimately going to have out of all of these drafts? Out of these ones that are in our packet right now under new business,
oh,
we're going to have
four.
AC.
AC. ACR. ACAB.
Really? We're still going to have one that's called non-discrimination?
Yes.
AC.
AC, right?
Yes.
This is the new draft.
But it's not called non-discrimination. It's still called non-discrimination policy, including harassment and retaliation.
That's correct.
Okay. And then there's also ACR, which is the reference.
The detail for that one.
Yeah.
Then ACAB, which we call harassment currently, but which will be sexual harassment.
Yes. But what's the difference between this new
draft,
8C
draft,
right, and the ACR? What's the difference between these two? Tell me.
ACR is, in the language of the attorneys, necessary because it goes into the detail of who is involved with certain things that AC doesn't do.
I think this 8C draft is the one we're supposed to be reviewing.
So ACR, for example, if you go to the second page of it, it tells the people who have an issue who they should go to.
Yes, I think the thing is that we just had the one with the name.
Yeah.
Right.
And that, and then we had the one filled in with NPS.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
That's what, okay.
Which was a bit confusing.
Yes.
So the ones that say new draft are the ones that were reviewing.
The ones that say new draft is the new.
Yes. Ones that were
reviewing. New. Yeah. But then. But then this one here is.
Use letters?
Yes.
Okay.
And the one that we're reviewing is ACR, the one that says new 8C draft.
Yes. And this is ACR. This is the same thing.
Yeah.
Well,
that has been,
I know. It's,
yes,
not,
it's the same thing. Yes.
Okay.
But
we're reviewing this one. Yes. This one. Okay, so this one needs to be updated because this says MASC December 2021, and this one is MASC August 2022. I'll just show you, Tony, if you don't mind.
Yeah, I see.
Because
yeah,
that's
what
so
I was
confused on. Okay.
Wait, sorry.
All right, we're going to do this way. So.
She's so good with shows.
I'm like,
this one and this one are the same.
It's also difficult.
But this one is still.
They are so similar.
I mean,
I think that one's
And the new ones are good. And one post change. And this is our first reading.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's reading.
Yes.
Okay.
However, let me review ACR. ACR. The ACR filled in and the ACR not filled in are the same.
Yes.
Yes.
Except
if it's obviously filled in.
Well, the reference, the source on the last page, I guess.
Maybe.
Is different.
Nope, that has actually 2022. So they're
right.
The same.
That has a separate chapter.
It's the reference on that one.
Yeah, I guess I just want to make sure that the reference is.
Yeah, I'll check it out. But the one without Nahant filled in my opinion, is the newest one.
Okay.
So not the one that says new EC, the one that's
that has nothing. The
yeah,
one that has nothing
file
on
ACR
is the newest.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah,
with the most recent date.
But I'll work on that
no,
in the
ACR.
Intro.
Okay.
Not the one that says new EC draft. The other one.
Yes, because it should say blank PS. Blank PS.
Yeah, the one that's blank.
All right. So do we?
So
AC. The AC is the easy one.
Yes. Yes. So.
All right. Now. The ACAB.
Yes.
That's the one. That the new draft is sexual harassment, and that one has new references and new language based on the law. My guess is there had to be, based on legislation, one that specifically says sexual harassment, which is why the current one, which I just did with you not long ago, if I'm not mistaken, 2020 needs to be changed again. Okay?
Yeah, and I think did you just say the source on this ACAB on the new draft also says December 2021? So I just want to make sure that that's the right source and not August 2022. Because I know they were just all updated.
Yes, that's correct. Notice 21's after 20 when we did this one. I didn't change, in other words, any of these dates.
Yeah.
I got them right from NASC.
Okay.
So I didn't change them. So, and unfortunately, we may have to do some of this. You may have to do some of this again.
Okay.
But that's the third one.
Yeah.
Okay. Then the fourth one, I do want to spend a little time on. This is the wellness policy.
Yeah.
So, this one, I tried to make it clearer by giving you the current one, 4 pages long, and then I actually typed this. No, I have no life. And I actually put an asterisk by hand on all the new language.
Okay,
so let me give you a history. Last year, a wellness committee, which comprised of myself, Kevin, Riley Edmonds, our counselor, Roxanne, our food service director, Jessica Martineau, our physical education teacher, Leanna Deloitte, our consultant on food matters and nutrition, and Cheryl Delisio, met. Some people came more often than others, but I kept everyone on the committee fully apprised of everything we did. Every time we had a meeting, I sent them a packet, said, this is what we're going to do, blah, 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 blah. So we took a 17-page long document called WellSat 3.0. And it's a national document that you take a wellness policy and you search for, do you have everything you got to have? And the WellSat said three things. You got to have it. It's good to have it. And really good policies have this. And we went to the really good policies. So if you take the asterisks, they are the language that we found in the really good policy column. And these are 11 recommendations from that committee. Once again, I was the only person who attended. Riley, Cheryl, and I were the only three that went to all the committees, but everybody got this months ago, and I communicated, look, read this, give me any of your input, and this is the result. So on the first page, we added, ensure that no student goes hungry while at school. All students will have a lunch at school. That's not required, interestingly enough, now that we have free and reduced lunch.
Yeah.
We forecasted. On page 2, number 7, the application for free and reduced lunch will be included with the weekly lunch orders. I don't know, we're doing that yet? I think we are. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
8, school meals will include fresh foods when possible and be supplied by locally grown sustainable sources. We're having a lot of trouble with locally grown sustainable sources, but there's something fresh in almost every, usually it's carrots or peppers or broccoli. So
broccoli, yeah.
We're heavy on broccoli.
Sliced cucumbers.
Page 3 has a lot of additions, 7 of them, I think. All students will be scheduled for 80 minutes of health and physical education per week. We said every, in the old policy, we didn't say 80 minutes. The best policies delineate how many minutes. So we did it. Physical activity breaks are encouraged. The district promotes joint use agreements for community use of school facilities and school use of community facilities for school activities. We didn't have anything about that in our policy. I mean, we obviously do that. The PTO uses our building. People can rent our building. All the community activities we have at our building is used for an emergency shelter. So we were doing it, but now we have it in our policy. School staff members are encouraged to model healthy eating and physical activity. I have my stepwatch. health and nutrition education, students and staff will receive encouragement, support, and education to adopt and maintain healthy behaviors, et cetera, et cetera. Nutrition is integrated into the health curriculum. That last sentence on monitoring and evaluation, I think we just added the word public. I think it said the wellness, I think our old policy said the wellness policy is available on the website. And so we corrected it to the best language. And so that's what the 11 changes that the committee recommends that you give every consideration to.
Just had a couple of comments about the references to the programs that were citing, and was wondering, should we have another resources section for like the versions that we were looking at when this was adopted? Only because if it changes, at least you have a source point to go back and say this is the revision that we used to make the deadline. Or are they so ever changing that? It's not.
I don't believe the WellSat 3.0 is a resource for the policy. I believe, if that's what you're asking.
I
misunderstood. I apologize.
It wasn't that. It was the Massachusetts School Nutrition Standards for Competitive Foods, and then adhere to exceed the USDA small snack standards. And so I had looked those both up just to see what they were.
and you know, one was revised in 22, and then the other one I think was maybe 21. And so I was just thinking, it's, you know, as a point of reference for
what year that you
looked at this, and like, so if there's any standards to update, that may be something that, you know, like a reference point.
Okay.
Source.
So I'll take those and I'll put those at the end with the dates.
Yeah,
reference.
I think so.
Okay, got it. Just let me assure you that on an annual basis, we have to submit with our consultant the fact that we are abiding by all of those standards. It's not like we do it in 2020 and we don't have to do it again. We have to submit that. As a matter of fact, we're doing it right now. We're in the process of submitting it.
Okay.
And that's crucial to us, because if we don't meet those standards, we don't get our reimbursement. So there's no wiggle room
that's
there.
That's good, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I haven't heard much about that lately, but yeah.
Okay, so if we're done talking about policies for now, the last item on the, one of the last items on the agenda is the MCAT status.
I'll keep it brief because I'm gonna have to talk to you both. Okay, I'm gonna have the opportunity to talk to you about this again. I'll get you one right in a second there, Mr. Parentrazzi.
Yeah, let me preface the lack of more detail with the results of the MCAS are embargoed until the 19th of September at noon.
Okay. Yeah.
So we can talk in generalities only until then.
Yeah.
And just, you know, the embargo comes from the Commissioner of Education, and there's no wiggle room in that embargo. I mean, if somebody had a newspaper reporter talk to them before that embargo, the commissioner would really come down on that individual.
Right, but we are allowed to talk to they're changing a little bit, saying we can talk to our staff, we can talk to the school committee. We can't go very wide with it. And we're also going to get more information.
Right.
So we don't have the state results yet. They're not out. We don't have growth.
Mm-hmm. Comparisons.
Yeah, so comparison districts. So that's all the facts that make it more, you know, give you context. And so I can basically share this with you that, you know, we had a good rate of proficient advanced in ELA. I show you there what the changes from the previous year, but again, we're talking about a different cohort of students, and both cohorts are very small.
Mm-hmm.
So comparing to the previous year isn't very helpful because it's different kids, and it might only be, it's comparing, you know, 30 kids versus a different 40 kids. So so this is where we are with ELA, an improvement with math, a slight change, again, -3%. I don't think that's a real difference. Different students, small difference. Science last year, we had 75% proficient, which was huge that year. We're still strong in science, I see. And our accountability percentile is still 79. So that's very good. And we made good progress. They call it, our progress was substantial.
So that's a progress in relation to previous years, or?
Yeah, I have to dig into that a little bit more, and I'll get you the context for it. They have a 50-page manual for administrators, seriously. And so it's not a percentile.
Okay.
You know, that 62%, it means that you are doing good at making progress towards your goal. And then they have a whole point system to evaluate that.
Okay.
I put more info to come because
yeah.
we have lots of nice charts and information that's going to fill it in, give you context. But I did mention over the summer how they're working to get this out, information out sooner. So the teachers have it in their hands In terms of results, it's been uploaded to our dashboard already. We've been meeting on the data. It used to come out in December, which wasn't as helpful as having it now. And so more and more to come.
Kevin, I would disagree about the usefulness of comparison, because I do, it's different crew of kids, right?
Yeah.
But it's the same educational program. So like what you offer to fourth grade math last year was the same as what you offered prior. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's true.
I do think, and I think it's important to kind of look at changes over time. I do think looking at just 1 year isn't as helpful as looking at like 3 years,
mm-hmm.
right? I think the wrinkle that I always wonder about as a school administrator is like, what effect did the pandemic have in terms of learning loss, et cetera? That may lessen the fund because we're one of the few districts that actually did do a full course of study. But I
mm-hmm.
think if you showed us 21, 2, and 3, and then the plus or minus,
mm-hmm.
like overall, if you're going up in math, 10 percentage points down isn't a big deal,
mm-hmm.
right? If your end sum is going up. But if you went down for 3 years or down, up, down, that is a different story,
mm-hmm.
right? In terms of the tale it tells. Do you disagree, Tony?
I don't disagree. I hedge that. I would say our numbers are so small, we'd have to look at more like 5 years.
Okay, yeah.
Because
yes.
I'd
yeah.
like to go back to
yeah.
some of the grades where we had larger numbers. Because when you have five
yeah.
kids taking a test.
Right, I was just going to say that the only
20%
is that is the, a tiny class size.
It's one
yeah.
kid.
Right, yeah.
So you have one, I mean, God forbid, we have one kid refuse to take the test. We're, you know, our numbers are in the bucket. I just want to remember, I just want to remind you that SGP, the
yes.
student
that's
growth percentile, is the magic one.
Yeah.
Tony Parentazzi is in the third grade. He scored a 66, whatever 66 means. That's the other thing. The numbers keep changing.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
The next time he takes a test in that same subject, he's compared to everybody who scored a 66
right.
in the state. That's the one that really shows how well we're doing. With a 5 year
yeah.
span of numbers, I mean, if we had 300 kids in a grade, I think you're dead on. 3 years would really give us a lot of information.
Over the small.
But because we're, you know, we had, in terms of top student population, if you think about it, we were kind of like, and then boom, 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 and now we're coming back up.
Yeah.
So you got to, I think
okay.
you got to span that dip.
And to your point, that's just the spread look is just one. It's score, it's spread, and SGP is where.
Yeah, and cohort analysis is great too.
Yeah.
When you have
yeah.
the third graders, the same, our school, the kids don't come and go a lot. They
right.
they come to Nahant, they stay.
Yep.
So looking at those, look at their
that's
score,
right.
and so I'll have that for you too.
Yes, okay. Like continuity.
Right, year after year.
And the item analysis, just so you know, our teachers get an item analysis.
Yeah, yeah, and it's a really nice
so
one.
So they would really look at this. Look at this
yeah.
question. Everybody got it wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Super
you know,
cool.
if you had 300 kids, it wouldn't be everybody. It would be
yeah.
you know, like...
Right.
50% got it wrong.
Yeah, yeah.
But here, we actually have some questions that nobody got. So
mm-hmm.
it's clear to the teacher, hey, I didn't cover that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's really important.
Yeah.
And then we can use the little codes to match it with an IXL lesson. So,
yes.
So that's a quick snapshot. You know, I just wanted to share it because,
thank you.
You know, it's they're trying to get it out earlier and they said, talk to your school committee about it. So.
Mm-hmm.
There you are with with some context, but you'll have graphs and color and
yeah.
More context
okay.
next time, or hopefully by next time.
Yeah, well, we should
19. Yeah,
yeah, that gives us 7.
Oh, I mean, as soon as we get it, I can get it right to you.
Okay,
it won't take any time to. I don't have to crunch it anymore. Just something.
Right.
Thank you.
Sure.
So, is there any other community business that you'd like to discuss?
No.
Wow. Any announcements?
No.
I have a motion.
Leona, why are you making a motion?
Let's make the motion to adjourn.
Well, let's not say
it. 9:30.
Next,
yeah.
All in favor?
No,
I'm not.
Is it?
You want me to stop this stuff?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.